The Koch brothers and their money have a presence at many universities across America, but it's not always easily apparent that that's going on and what effect it might have both on the operations of universities and also on government policy. And joining us now to break down one particular aspect of this is Taylor Lincoln, Director of Research at Public Citizens Congress Watch Division. Welcome to the show.
Hi there, can you hear me okay? And thank you for having me.
I can, thank you for joining us. So we wanted to talk about a recent write-up involving the George Washington University's Regulatory Studies Center, which talks about regulatory policy issues and apparently has a pretty strong connection with the Koch brothers. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so this is a program that has this kind of anodyne name, the Regulatory Studies Center at George Washington University. It's run by a woman who was a Bush appointee at the end of the Bush administration that ran the she was effectively the government's regulatory czar at the end of the Bush administration. And this program purports to be a neutral, unbiased program, and we analyzed what their comments were. They comment to the government on regulations and found out that they come out against regulations ballpark about 98% of the time or 96% of the time.
Just out of curiosity, because I did find that statistic to be very interesting, do we have any idea what the 4% of the time is or the 2%? Like what regulations are they in favor of?
We actually do, and it's a kind of curious case. What they came out in favor of was a proposal by the FDA to regulate the nicotine content of cigarettes. But the proposal also included a request that they let free nicotine content in non-combustible cigarettes. So they regulated traditional cigarettes, and they wanted them to let free the nicotine content on non-combustible cigarettes, which makes me wonder if that was actually a backdoor deregulatory request as well.
Yeah, that's interesting. Are the non-combustible cigarettes, are we talking about like vaping or something like that?
I think so, yes.
Interesting, okay. Well, maybe that'll win over some of the college students for them, perhaps. So how significant then, I mean, you talked a little bit about the history, but in terms of the continued funding and operation of the Regulatory Studies Center, how significant is Koch money there?
Well, so they don't say who their funders are for the most part, but we're able to look at foundations and what they disclose contributing to the Regulatory Studies Center. And we're able to conclude that big contributors include the Koch Foundation run by Charles Koch. Exxon is another big contributor. There's another thing called the Searle Freedom Trust, which is almost a cousin of the Koch Foundation. It's another free market foundation. The U.S. Chamber of Commerce is another, and then a whole bunch of industry trade associations and even some individuals who are big figures in the anti-regulatory world in Washington, like, for instance, David Rosen, who helped to write the proposal to freeze fuel economy standards and just recently was bumped up to being the deputy attorney general.
So I've previously read about the Koch brothers setting up like endowed chairs and things like that at universities. I know in Florida they get involved with economics departments, things like that. How broad is this sort of issue? I know that that's not the principal focus of your study, but are we talking about many universities across the United States that they are personally involved in?
And that's an excellent question, and I think it is part and parcel, a big part of our study. So Charles Koch has been talking about using universities to influence policy since at least 1974, and was very explicit about it. He said that this is a way to influence policy that doesn't evoke the same kind of reaction as traditional politics does. And they have built this program up over the years, and according to one conversation that was recorded, unbeknownst to the Kochs, back in 2016, they're funding more than 50 university centers right now.
Wow. So there's a good chance that if someone is listening to this going to a university, they might be at one that has something like this. And yeah. I'm trying to understand, like, what the, from the point of view of a student at one of these universities, or even the faculty at one of these universities, of grad students, what is the benefit to the university? What does this actually have to do with the university? Are professors working at this center? Are students helping to write up reports? Are they being indoctrinated into this sort of work?
I guess it's kind of, I suppose it could probably vary by university. I would say that a lot of the universities that the Kochs have funded have not been huge names on a national scale. College of Charleston, Troy University in Alabama, and a Clemson University. I mean, I don't mean to denigrate those universities, but traditionally they haven't been Ivy League schools and such. So I suppose one of the aspects for the Kochs is they're bringing in, they're pumping in resources and funding. And you know, what university is going to look away from that, all things being equal? So I think that that's a big one. I think it also probably raises university's profile, although it can come with some baggage. But the base camp for the Kochs has always been George Mason University here in Northern University. And that university's profile has been risen, has been increased significantly because of the Kochs funding. It's also taken a lot of hits to its reputation, but you know, maybe they could argue nobody even know who we were if it hadn't been for all of this funding from the Kochs.
And so, as you pointed out, this is a way to have an influence on politics without sort of raising people's red flags, like through traditional political means. And so, the sort of work that you and the center are doing to shed light on this is incredibly important. And so, we appreciate your contribution in that area.
Well, I really thank you for having me.
Thank you. Here on the Damage Report, we talk a lot about the big banks and their ways of getting rich off the poor. They saturate the market, but there are other options. And I've got info on a socially and environmentally responsible financial institution that has no ATM fees, gives you cash back on every purchase. They even commit 10% of their earnings to charity. It's called Aspiration. And if you go to aspiration.com/TYT to sign up, you'll get these perks, and that's more money to spend or to save. Or to spend, just treat yourself.